All right, we're going to do a couple things today with forms. We're going to talk about getting the layout of forms correct. We're going to review what we did before. Actually, I probably should put that first on the list because we're going to review what we did before and add on a little bit to it. Then we are going to talk about formatting the form via CSS. And we're going to talk about accessibility for forms. We talked about accessibility concerning websites in general, and we said that people with different abilities and disabilities should be able to access a page. And there's some challenges unique to forms, and we're going to talk about them. So I'm not really sure what order we're going to do these in. We might do these in any order, but definitely the first thing we're going to do is review what we had before. All right. So if I pull down what we had from last time, we had this. This form, and form, as you remember before, is a way for the user to supply some data to the web server. Web server, again, responds to requests for web pages. The basic, most simplest kind of web page is what's called a static page, and that's a page that is built entirely in HTML. There's nothing dynamic about it. And what dynamic means, it means it changes without someone manually going in and changing the code. Alright? I mean, any web page can change if someone goes in by hand and changes it. But when we talk about dynamic pages, we're talking about pages that have code in them, so it doesn't take a human to go in to change the page to get different results under different circumstances. And we can think of tons of different dynamic web pages. You know, Google's an obvious one. Results that you get change depending on what you typed in the search box. It also changes depending on your physical location of where you've typed it in. Canvas would be another example. It changes based on who you've logged in as. All right, and it changes based on stuff that I do. In other words, if I add an assignment to Canvas for this course, you'll see it the next time you log on. All right, so that page is made just for you on the fly. We can think of other examples, too. A TV network that shows its schedule, you know. It will show the schedule, like, for today, starting at the time that it is, right? And it might even do some adjustments based on where you are. So it will show you, like, in California time, if you're on the West Coast, if it will show you in Eastern Daylight Time if you're on the East Coast. So forms are one way to give data to a web server. So the web server can customize a page for the particular user that's seeing it, the particular request. And what we did is, since we don't write any server-side scripting in this class, I wrote a form that submits to Bing's server-side scripting. And so if I search for HTML, interesting. I was playing around with something. Notice the first one's in French. Let me open up a different browser. There we search for HTML. Now notice something interesting here. And this is something that I did just playing around. Notice that these are in French, some of these. was playing around with the code for this, and if you add a CC to the query string, you can specify the language that you want. So I said CC equals FR, and that gave me French. So we're going to use that in today's example. So that's why it showed French. It was what I was playing around with earlier. But here's here's what the basic Bing page for HTML would look like, assuming that you're in English. All right. So let's look at the code that does this. And we want to note several things about this. First of all, we have a form tag. The form tag goes around everything that we send to the server. Everything with a name gets sent to the server. So actually the button doesn't get sent to the server, but I can make the button go get sent to the server. Sometimes that's a useful thing to do by giving the button a name. So I'll give it a name, and now we'll see this on the query string when we go and submit it. The action of the form is a server-side script that gets called. Someone will either give that to you, or if you're the developer that's doing the server-side coding, you'll know what it is because you've made it up. All right. In this case, I know that the script I want to call is http://www.bing.com/search. The method is get. Get puts the data on the query string so it's visible. Your other option is post, and post sends the data, but sort of in an invisible way. All right, so you don't see the actual data that's being sent. And for people that are learning, get is a good way to do it because you can actually look at the query string and see like what you're actually sending. So get's probably a good idea while you're learning it. The reason you wouldn't use get is if you had some secure data. For example, if I was sending a password, if I was logging in with a password, I wouldn't want to send the password as part of the query string because then anyone peeking over your shoulder might be able to see your password. So I might use post if I was sending a password, for example. All right. So action is the name of the server-side script we're calling. Method is either get or post. Get sends it in a visible way. Post sends it in an invisible way. Get sends it as part of the query string. Post sends it another way. You then have the form fields. And in our case, we only have one. We have two fields. We have a text box and we have a button. All right? Now, the text box has a name of Q. The reason it has a name of Q is because that's what the Google server, Bing server-side script is expecting. It's expecting the name of the field that contains what we're searching for to be called Q. So when we do a search here, notice that's what it says up in the query string. Search Q equals CSS. So Bing, it knows that, well, that CSS, that's what I'm searching for. And therefore, that's what it goes out to its database, and the script runs it, and it does all of its preparation, and it delivers you a web page that's made just for you, just for this request. It's amazing to think that all that goes on in that heartbeat, all right? And you get back from the server a request that's already made, that you have made. And it's formatted as an HTML page. That's an important thing to understand. Whether you're talking about a static page or a dynamic page, the user always gets sent back an HTML page. That's just how it works, all right? Because that's what browsers understand is HTML. So of course that's what browsers are going to get back. All right. Any question on this? All right, let's look and let's add the CC option. And this form's going to be messy for a second. I just want to get this to work, and then we'll clean it up a little bit. So I'm going to say search. I'm going to say language. So I can search for CSS and use a language of French. And it gives me CSS search results page, and the language of the page is French. Let's go back here. Let's say we want the language of English. Oh, that didn't work. Skip that. This is something I just thought of trying before class, and it looked like it worked before class because I was getting French lookups, but it didn't seem to be working anymore. All right, anyhow. So I got rid of the language. My mistake on that. There's HTML. All right. Let me do a Bing search some other way. HL in Google looks like it does the translation. So let's try that. Let's switch this over to use Google. So what am I going to change to make this use Google? I'm going to make it use the server-side script name on Google's end. So it looks like the language is HL, the query is AS underscore Q. So let's see if we can get that to work. So I'm going to say AS, probably stands for advanced search underscore Q, and I'm going to try this. It language was HL. And that changes to Google. So let's try that. All right, gave me French. Good. Let's try English. Gave me English. Good. So we're back in business. Yay. All right. So, any questions about what we have now? The only thing that's a little tricky, the only thing that I see as being a little tricky here is how I knew that that was called AS underscore Q and how I knew that it was called HL. And the only way I knew that is by going to actually run the advanced search and looking up here to see what it is asking for. All right, HL equals EN, that's probably EN for English. ASQ equals CSS. So, it's again, it's the Q, but AS means advanced search. All right. Again, for our assignment, I give you the names of those things. So we'll take a look at our assignment before I'm done. So, but I give you the names of the fields, and I give you the names of the script. All right? I just, because I wanted to use this particular one, I sort of just reverse engineered it a little bit. All right, let's make this look better. All right? We're going to make this look better progressively. First thing I'm going to do is, what is a form? A form is really a list of fields that you send to the server, right? So really, a form is an unordered list. So I'm going to put my form data in an unordered list. And each line is a list item. So I do that, and this isn't going to look right, good right away, but we're moving in that direction. All right, so at least they're not like alongside of each other. The way I had it before was horizontal. If you think of us creating a big form that has a lot of things, a horizontal wouldn't work. So, for example, like for Google's advanced search, there's a lot of fields for Google's advanced search. We wouldn't want those. Here's Google's advanced search. There's like a dozen or so fields. All right? We wouldn't want those to be strung across the page horizontally, because that would make it really difficult to read. So we stack them vertically. That's the first step. Now, we probably don't want the bullet points, right? How do we get rid of the bullet points? Through CSS. All right? Remember, if you don't like the way that it looks, you can always change it through CSS. You should use the tags that are appropriate for the situation, and then use CSS to get the appearance that you want. So, for example, a form is really a list of fields. That's really what a form is. So it should be in an unordered list tag. And each field is a list item. Each field is one of the items that you're going to be sending to the server. So it really should be an LI. So I make it an LI. I don't lie to it and make each one a separate paragraph, for example. That would give me them stacked vertically without the bullet point. So maybe you would think that would be a good idea. It's not. is a list, so make it a list. I can always change it via CSS. And in the interest of time, I'm going to put my style code right in my HTML. That doesn't mean that you should do that. And I'm going to say my UL list style type none. So we got rid of them. Now, those of us that can see, knows what belongs to each other just based on what's where they're physically located. So for example, search. I know which text box is for search because it's the one with the label right next to it that says search. Remember, however, how a person that is blind navigates the screen. They navigate the screen by the screen being read to them through a screen reader. And they don't use the mouse to point to something. They use the arrows and the tabs and things like that. So even though this seems like a very simple problem, like what field is that text box? Well, of course it's search, because that's what's next to it. People that can't see can't tell that the word search is next to it. So we have to tie that label together with the text box. We have to put something in our code that joins those two together, so that whether you can see or not, you can tell that those two belong together. And that is the label tag. The label tag works like this. Label for equals AS underscore Q. Where AS underscore Q is the ID of that text box. Now, this gets a little confusing because I have a name and an ID. And in this case, I made them the same just to make my life easier. What's the difference between the two? The name is what's going to get sent to the server. So that has to match what's being sent to the server. The ID is what the label tag uses to associate the label with the input field. So that ID links up with this guy so that someone with the screen reader will tell them, oh yeah, that field that you're in is for your search term. I'm going to do the same thing for this. And I'm going to give it its ID. Now, just to keep things easy on myself, I'm going to give them the same ID as I'm giving them a name. And that's fine. Now, if I go back and look at this, it's not going to look anything different. This is one of those things that you do for accessibility that doesn't really affect people that aren't using a screen reader. However, we're clever people, all right? And we might be able to use that to make a nice look of the appearance, all right? So wouldn't it be nice if all these text boxes aligned? That's kind of sloppy that this text box goes to here, this text box goes to here. It'd be nice if they all lined up. So I'm going to do that, and I'm going to do that the wrong way first, then I'm going to do it the right way. So I'm going to say label width. Pixels. Seems like a reasonable thing to do. They'll make all the labels 100 pixels wide. So they'll all be that wide. The text box will line up right next to it. Except it doesn't work. Alright? I told you in advance it wouldn't work. That way when it didn't work, you wouldn't say, oh, this guy is slipping. He doesn't know what he's talking about. Alright? Anyone have an idea why that didn't work? I have mentioned this, I believe. I may have mentioned it to my cat, forgetting that I wasn't in school or something, so maybe I didn't mention it to this class, but I have mentioned this. I know I mentioned this semester. Any thoughts on why that doesn't work? Yes?
Well, it's not like the label box is still the same, but it's the fact that the search and the language, those words are short, one is long. So you're not changing the size of that, you're changing the distance between.
Sort of. There's a very specific, you're right, that's why they're different widths, because that tag, the label tag, takes as wide as the content is. So if I had a long word, it would be a long word. If I had a short word, the label's going to be short. Where does the label and form field line up next to each other? Are they on top of each other or are they side by side? The input box and the label, are they side by side or one's on top of the other? They're side by side. What does that mean if it's side by side? What kind of tag is it? It means it's inline. Guess what? Width doesn't work with inline tags. I make up these rules, alright? But what can you do? This sounds like a solution that like a 10-year-old would come up with. Well, we'll just make it an inline block tag then. All right, and sure enough, that's what you do. You say display inline block, and now this should work. Inline block essentially is a cross between an inline and a block tag. So it's still inline, so it's still stacked next to it, not on top of it, but with an inline block tag, you can put a width on it, and it will work. So if I do this, then, boom, it works, and it lines up. And that's pretty cool, but we can do better. Yeah, let's do better. Wouldn't it be cool if these were alongside these? You know, if the label was right up next to it? Let's do that. How do you think we do that? How can I make, in other words, right now the label goes from here to here. In fact, let's put a background color on the label. Putting a background color on a label is not a label, but just any tag, is a good idea sometimes if you're trying to figure things out. If you're wondering, like, why doesn't this work? You know, temporarily put some colors on those things, on the things that aren't working. And aren't working the way that you want to. And then sometimes those colors can help you see, oh, that's what's going on. So if I put a background of yellow on this, I notice that, all right, that's the label. So how's the text aligned? It's left aligned. Do you think that we can align the text to the right? Sure, we can put a person on the moon, right? We can put a person on the moon, we can align the text to the right. Sometimes I wonder if NASA thinks that, like, they probably shouldn't have put a person on the moon, because now there's, like, no excuse for not being able to do anything. Like, no, of course we could do that. And what is the properties for that? Well, it's just so simple as saying text align right. push that button over. Right now, the button is over here.
Position.
Something to do with the position. We could use, we could actually do this a few different ways. Padding would work. A margin would work. Let's try padding. Now this gets to be a little weird because input is used for both of these tags. So what I could do is I could give an ID. I wouldn't want to set the style rule for input. Let's do that. Let's do it wrong first. Again, warning, I'm making a mistake. Alright? Actually, I shouldn't do that because it's a great cover for a teacher to, when they make a mistake, to pretend that they just made it just to see if you guys were paying attention, you know. So I shouldn't announce my mistakes, but I'll announce this one. I'll give a left padding of 100 pixels. That really didn't do what I wanted it to do. Actually, let's try this. LI padding. That's also not going to work. That pushed the button over, but pushed all those other things over too, right? Because they're all in LIs. What I could do is something like this. I can put an ID on the last row that says, hey, this is a row that contains a submit button. And how do you make a style rule for an ID? You say pound sign and then the ID. For you younger, cooler social media types, the hashtag. If I do that, the style rule is going to apply only to the row, only to the LI that has an ID of submit. And so this should do pretty much what I want it to. It's a little bit off, but I could bump it over if I wanted to, maybe make it 102 or something. So now this form looks good, right? I'm not going to print it out and hang it on my refrigerator. It doesn't look that good. But it looks certainly a lot better than if everything was strung out on one line or the bullet points were there or the labels were off and not everything wasn't lined up. This is pretty neatly aligned. This is a nice functional form. All right. Any questions about what I did to get to that point? And we've done two things by doing this. We've by putting a label in, we've made the form more accessible for people that can't see the form. And we also use that as a way of styling stuff. So that's a nice little, that's a side benefit. Those two things sort of went together. All right. Now, notice a problem here. I could type in, I'm going to do this. I'm going to search for Polish. Lang. LR equals Lang. Let's see. Let's try putting PL in here. There we go. Let's look for French. Finally got the coding right. All right, there it is in French, yay. Let's try Spanish. SP, I wonder, or ES? SP didn't work, let's try ES. There we go, ES. All right. So, we could pick, I think there's sort of a standard two-digit language code. And there's a whole mess of languages, right? Let's try BG. Bulgarian. Give us some Bulgarian. So these are standard list of codes. What is wrong with the way our form is laid out then? What's wrong with our form? I won't say what's wrong with it, because it works, right? But what would make it hard to use?
You'd have to know the
code. You have to know all the codes. For example, like, let's say I wanted to do a search and I wanted to return back things were Bulgarian, I'm liable to type in Bulgarian. It doesn't know what Bulgarian is. It needs it formatted a certain way. All right? So what are we going to do about that? How can we make this function a lot easier for the user?
Use a select box.
Use a select box. Limit the number of options the user can choose. And limit the number of options to the options that we know works. Because again, not every language works. You know, there's not a Klingon or whatever. In fact, that's exactly what Google does. Notice the language, they don't have a text box where I can type in anything I want. They have a drop down where I can select from a list of things. And these are all the languages that Google understands, that Google can do something with. So they can give me Icelandic if I want. And that is lang_is. So let's see if that works for us. Are good for when the text can be literally anything and we can't anticipate what it is. So What kind of fields, what are some examples of fields that we might have in a text box on a typical form? Well, we said the term that we search for would be an example of a text box. What are some other things that we would put in a text box? Would we put name in a text box? Yeah. Would we put phone number in a text box? Yeah. Would we put email address in a text box? Would we put state in a text box? Probably not, right? Because we want to get accurate data, right? We don't want, and again, a lot of times these web pages and these forms are connected to a database. So we want things stored in a consistent manner. So in other words, I wouldn't want someone to type in OH for Ohio, and another person type in Ohio, the full word, right? So I would want to have it stored in a standardized way. If I decide I'm going to store the abbreviation in the database, then I'm going to store OH in the database. All right? So I want to make sure everyone picks OH. And OH is valid for Ohio. OK is valid for Oklahoma. But OU is not, does not correspond to a valid state. So I wouldn't want the ability for someone to type in or select OU. So, the answer to that is to have different kinds of form controls. And part of your job when you define a form is to decide what the proper form controls are. We'll go over more of these next time. But let's run through an example of what some of these form controls are. We already have three of them, right? And I showed you the coding for two of them, and the third one we talked about. We have a text box. We have a submit button. We have a drop-down list. And again, some people call these other things, but that's the term I use typically. A drop-down list has an arrow. When you click on the arrow, a list drops down to show you your list of legal selections. What are some other things that you can have on a form besides these that maybe you've seen on other forms?
Email.
Email typically would be in a text box.
Text area.
A text area. Oh, like to send an email. Yeah. A text area. And that is where you have multiple lines, like if you're going to send an email. Or, you know, it would be horrible to say, type in your complaint here and give them just a tiny little text box to type it in, right? If you want your feedback, we're going to give you a text area where you can type paragraphs so they can tell you how great you're doing. All right? What's another example? Radio button. Radio button is like the radio button in a car. It's also, it's like a drop-down list in the sense that you have a list of choices. The difference in typically they're mutually exclusive choices in a drop-down. You actually can configure a drop-down to allow multiple choices, but that's rarely used and we're not going to talk about it. In other words, I could have a drop-down that had freshman, sophomore, junior, senior, or I could have radio buttons that say freshman, sophomore, junior, senior. Why would I use one versus the other? Yes?
Drop-down list is more for, like, states there's 50 of them versus
right.
Four selections.
Exactly. The advantage of a radio button is you can see all the options at a glance. You don't have to search through a list. The disadvantage of a radio button is if there's too many selections, then it takes up just too big of a screen, whereas a drop-down list is nice and concise. In other words, it only shows you the list when you drop down. So if you have 50 or 100 selections, that is probably a better way to go. If you have a less number of selection, this is the way to go. But you could do either or both, right? You could have a drop-down, for example, for freshman, sophomore, junior, senior. Why would you want to do that? I don't know. Maybe you have a bunch of other drop-downs on your page, and you want it to look consistent. So instead of having 5 drop-downs and a radio button set, you have 6 drop-downs. That just makes it more consistent. I don't know what's going on out in the hall today. I just hear these noises, you know. That's another one. The last main one that we're going to talk about is a checkbox. The checkbox is, think of a checkbox as being a yes or no question. Check means yes, no check means no. All right. The difference between a checkbox and radio buttons are checkboxes are not mutually exclusive. So, for example, if you had a checkbox that says, are you interested in baseball? Are you interested in football? Are you interested in soccer? Are you interested in golf? If they were done with checkboxes, you could check yes for all of them, or you could check no for all of them. With a radio button, it might be something like, what's your favorite sport? And you couldn't pick baseball and football, because if you pick baseball, it would unselect the rest of them. So you have to decide as a form designer, do I want someone to select just one of these things, or do I want someone to be able to select a bunch of these? So look at the assignment. I wanted to cover it in class, but we're a little short on time. Look on the assignment, and part of your job in the assignment is to decide which of these form controls will work the best. Now, we haven't covered these, how to code these, and if you want to, you're welcome to read ahead or go online to figure out how to code these, but we'll be covering them next week as well. You can start the assignment simply by doing everything in a text box, and then going back later and redoing it with the proper form control. And let me say that louder again so you catch it and people don't turn everything in a text box. For this assignment, you should not end up with everything in a text box. But that is a good starting point, all right, if you want to work on the assignment and we haven't got over these things and maybe you tried reading the book but it was hard to understand or whatever. We will go over the rest of these controls next time, because your form should have a mix of different kinds of controls. But as a starting point, again, I stress in class a lot of times not to try to do everything at once. Try doing your assignments a piece at a time. And one way you could do this one a piece at a time is first do everything as a text box, then go back and change some of the things to some of the other controls we're going to study later. All right. Any questions? We will see you in lab.